Now we'll see the third module. The third module consists of your optical sources. So under your optical sources, we'll be seeing about your LEDs and LEDs, laser diodes, photodetectors, and optical receivers. So under this, first we'll see about your energy band. So here your energy band is nothing but, we know that a semiconductor material is going to have the conduction properties, where the conduction properties is going to lie somewhere between those of the metals and insulators. So here we know that a silicon is going to have 4 electrons in its outer shell, where this 4 electrons are going to make covalent bonds with the neighboring atoms in a crystal. So here the outer shell electrons are going to be called as the valence electrons. The conduction properties of the semiconductors can be interpreted with the help of your energy band diagrams. So in a semiconductor, the valence electrons are going to occupy a band of energy levels which is going to be called as valence band, and this is the lowest allowable band of allowed states there. The next highest band of allowed energy levels are for the electrons is called the conduction band. So here we are going to see the energy level diagram, which is going to show the excitation of electron from the valence band to the conduction band. So here in this case we are going to have the valence band, where in this valence band we are going to have a set of electrons, and in this conduction band we are going to have the holes to be present here. So when an external force is going to be applied to this valence band or to the semiconductor material, the electrons will be excited from the valence band to the conduction band. So when the electrons are going to be excited from the valence band to the conduction band, a hole is going to be created in the valence band, and electron is going to be as the electron goes to the conduction band, the electron concentration is going to be more in the conduction band. So the difference between the valence band and the conduction band is going to be called as the energy gap. So we can see that this is going to be the electron hole concentration there. So you know that the valence band, when the electrons move from the valence band to the conduction band, you are going to have the holes to be present, that is going to be represented by the hole concentration. So it is called as hole concentration distribution there. And here in this conduction band, we are going to have more number of electrons to be present. So these electrons are going to be called as your electron concentration distribution, where the energy is going to be represented as 2kb into T, where kb is going to be the Boltzmann constant and T is going to be the temperature there. And the number of, so we say that this is your number of electron states and this is your number of hole states there. So the difference between the conduction band and the valence band is going to be called as the energy gap. So energy gap is equivalent to Ec minus Ev. So in a pure crystal, if I am going to take at low temperature, the conduction band is going to be completely empty of electrons and the valence band is going to be completely full of electrons there. So here the two bands are going to be separated by energy gap and the band gap, where there is going to be no energy level there. So as we are going to raise the temperature, some electrons will get excited from the valence band to the conduction band and it will cross the band gap energy there. So for silicon, the excitation energy must be greater than 1.1 electron volts there, which is the band gap energy. So the electron excitation process will give rise to a concentration N of free electrons in the conduction band. Here in this case, where there is going to be an equal concentration of holes present in the valence band. So here in this case, so both the electrons and the holes are going to be mobile within the semiconductor material. So this causes the electrical conductivity that is going to be present in the semiconductor material there. So here an electron in the valence band can move into a vacant hole there in the conduction band. So here when the holes move in the opposite direction to that of the electron flow. So when an electron is going to propagate or move along the fiber or move along the semiconductor, it is going to interact with the periodically arranged atoms of the material there. Where you are going to apply an experience, where these atoms are going to experience an external forces there. So suppose when you are going to apply a force, which is going to be an external force is going to be applied onto the material, the electrons that are going to be present in the valence band are going to be accelerated, and here you are going to have the forces are going to be exerted on the electron and the electrons are going to be accelerated. And it is going to, where the electrons are going to have an effective mass Me. So we can write that your external force is equivalent to Me into your acceleration of the crystal there, A of the crystal, acceleration of the crystal there. So we write force is equal to mass times acceleration there. So the effect of all the forces that are going to be exerted on the electron within the material are incorporated by the into your effective mass. So here the concentration of the electrons and holes is known as the intrinsic carrier concentration, where Ni. And for a perfect material, we say that there is going to be no imperfections or impurities there. That means number of electrons is equal to number of holes is equal to Ni, the intrinsic carrier concentration. I denotes the intrinsic carrier concentration, which can be expressed as K into e exponential of minus Eg by 2 Kb into T, where Eg is nothing but the energy gap and Tb is Kb is nothing but the Boltzmann constant. T is going to be the temperature. Here in this case, your H is going to be the Planck's constant. Me and Mh are going to be the effective mass of the electron and the holes there. So here in this case, the electron can be represented, the free space electron is going to have a mass of 9.11 into 10 power minus 31 kg. So here this K is going to be represented as 2 into 2 pi kb T by H square the whole power 3 by 2 into Me Mh the whole power 3 by 4. This is your electron hole concentration and the intrinsic carrier concentration there. So here you will see a problem there. Consider the following parametric values for gallium arsenide at 300 K, where electron rest mass M is equal to 9.11 into 10 power minus 31 kg. Effective electron mass M is equal to 0.068 M, that is 6.19 into 10 power minus 32 kg. Effective hole mass is nothing but 5.10 into 10 power minus 31 kg. And band gap energy is 1.42 electron volts. What is the intrinsic carrier concentration? So we know intrinsic carrier concentration Ni is equal to K into exponential of Eg minus of Eg by 2 kbt. So where K is nothing but 2 into 2 pi kbt by H square whole power 3 by 2 into Me Mh the whole power 3 by 4. So now we are going to substitute the Ni values there. So if I substitute these Ni values, I can find out what is going to be intrinsic carrier concentration, that is nothing but 2.62 into 10 power 6 per centimeter cube. So here next is we are going to see that we want to increase the conduction properties of the semiconductor. So in order to improve the conduction properties of the semiconductor, we are going to add traces of impurities there. So these impurities can be either from a group 5 element or it can be from a group 3 element there. So if the impurities are going to be from a group 5 elements, that is the example is going to be your phosphorus, arsenic or antimony. In this case, we call that adding of impurities is going to be called as your doping. And this doped semiconductor is going to be called as the extrinsic material there. So when I'm going to add group 5 electrons, so group 5 elements, in that case I'll be having 5 valence electrons there in the outer shell. So when these 5 electrons will, when they combine, when they are going to be combined with your silicon atom, what happens is they replace the 4 silicon atom. The 4 electrons are going to be used for covalent bonding with the silicon atom, with the 4 electrons available in the silicon atom, and the 5th electron is going to be loosely bound there, which is going to be available for the conduction process there. So here when I am going to give, it is going to give rise to an occupied level, that is below the conduction level, what happens is we are going to have a level called a donor level, where the donor level are going to consist of more electrons. The electrons are going to be present in this donor level there. So the impurities are going to be called as donors because they can give up electrons to the conduction band. One electron is there where this loosely bound electrons will form a level under the conduction band, that is called the donor level there. So here we can see that there is going to be an increase in the free electron hole concentration in the conduction band. So here the current is going to be carried by electrons. And it is going to be called as your n-type material, because the electrons are, when I am going to add group 5 elements, I am going to have more electrons to be present, and this since more electrons are going to be present, we call this as an n-type material. So we can see that this is your valence band. So the loosely bound electrons will form and revel under the conduction band, which is going to be called as the donor level. So we know that this freely bound electrons are going to be accumulated in your conduction band, and we have the electron concentration distribution to be high, and here this hole concentration is going to be less. So this is your hole concentration distribution, this is your electron concentration distribution. Because it is an n-type material, more electrons are going to be present. Okay, so here this is your ionization of the donor impurities, which is going to increase the electron hole concentration distribution there. Next is your conduction. Again, I said we can go by adding your group 3 elements there. So in this group 3 elements, we are going to have 3 valence electrons. So these 3 valence electrons will make covalent bonds with the 3 electrons available in the outer shell of your silicon atom there. And as a result, what happens is one hole will be present. So, and a hole which is going to be have the property which is going to be identical to that of the donor electron there. So, here you are going to have an unoccupied level just above the valence band. So, in this case, a hole is going to be created. When a hole is going to be created, there is going to be a level that is going to be generated above the valence band. So, that level is going to be called as the acceptor levels there. So here in this case, when electrons are going to be excited from the valence band to the this acceptor level, then the free hole concentration is going to increase in the valence band. So as a result, what happens is we have the conduction is going to be result of the hole flow there. So here we are going to call this type of material to be p-type material. So p-type material, there are going to be more holes to be present. We are going to have the acceptor level. So we say that the conduction is going to occur when electrons are going to be excited from the valence band to this acceptor level there. We are excited when there are going to be more holes. So as a result, free hole concentration is going to increase in the valence band. So we call this type of material to be your p-type material. So this is the energy band diagram there. So this is your valence band. This is going to be your acceptor level, where in this acceptor level, when the electrons are going to be excited, then more number of holes are going to be available in this acceptor level. When more holes are going to be available, the electrons which moves from the valence band will go and occupy the acceptor, holes present in the acceptor level there. So as a result, more holes will be formed in this valence band. So we say that the hole concentration is going to be more in the valence band, and electron concentration is going to be less in the conduction band. So this type of material is going to be called as a p-type material. So we are going to see what is direct and indirect band gap. So for direct and band gap and indirect band gap, what we are going to do is we are going to see that whether the electron transition is going to take place from the valence band to the conduction band, or from the conduction band to the valence band by the process of your absorption or emission of a photon. In this case, both the energy and the momentum should be conserved there. So in this case, when a photon of energy h mu is going to have a momentum h v mu by c is going to be a very small value there. So when a photon which is going to have an energy and its momentum h mu by c is going to be a very small one there. So as semiconductors, we can classify the semiconductors as the either direct band gap or indirect band gap materials. So here this is going to depend on the shape of the band gap as a function of the momentum k. So here you are going to have a recombination of the electron and hole is going to take place. When the recombination of the electron and hole is going to take place, emission of the photon occurs. So here the recombination process will say states that when the recombination process takes place, if the electron and the hole is going to have the same momentum value, we call that as your direct band gap material there. So we can see that in your direct band gap material, this is going to be your valence band, where it is going to consist of more number of electrons, and this is going to be your conduction band. So here in this case, this maximum when going to be there in your when an electron is going to fall from the conduction band to the valence band, and a light is going to be emitted with an energy of h mu there. So that energy is called as your photon energy h mu. That is, in a direct band gap, an electron is going to fall from, when an electron falls from the conduction band to the valence band, and this this maximum of the conduction band and minimum of the maximum of the valence band and minimum of the conduction band are going to be at the same point there. So here this is called as direct band gap energy. So for indirect band gap materials, what happens is the conduction band minimum and the valence band maximum is going to occur at different energy levels or at different values of the momentum. So here When it occurs at different values of the momentum, then in that case, the band-to-band recombination will involve a third particle there. So to conserve the momentum, because the photon momentum is going to be very small. So here we say that the phonons are going to serve this purpose. So because of the crystal lattice vibrations there. So here your electron recombination. So here in this case, we see that this is your valence band and this is going to be a conduction band. The maximum of the conduction band and the minimum of the conduction, maximum of the valence band and minimum of the conduction band differs at different values or occur at different values of K. So in that case, when an electron falls from the conduction band to the valence band, we have two different energy levels there. So here in this case, this is going to have, when a photon falls from this energy level to this energy level, and when an electron falls from this energy level to the valence band, a photon is going to be emitted. So we can call that as the photon energy is going to be the band gap energy, indirect band gap energy plus the energy of the photon there. But when it comes to a lower level, so in that case, we can say it as your indirect energy gap minus your photon energy there. So this is called as indirect band gap energy. The energy levels at K is equal to K at, for energy levels of the valence band and the conduction band is going to be at for different values of your K there. Thank you.